Welcome to EPG Pathshala. This module will deal with air pollution. The phenomenon of air pollution is well known. Everybody feels it, knows it, but he doesn't mean its scientific meaning. He is also not aware what are real air pollutants, what are their sources, and how do they affect us. Here, in this module, I will deal with these situations. The fundamental question is, what is air pollution and what are air pollutants? The trace atmospheric constituents such as gases, dust, fumes or odor are present in unexpectedly high concentrations or in concentrations which can cause sub-detrimental effect are called air pollutants. Basically, the substances present in atmosphere which have some detrimental effect, they can harm us, they are toxic to us, they are called air pollutants. The definition of air pollutant is, you will find, different in different books. I have taken this definition from a celebrated atmospheric chemist, Peter Brimblecom. He has been the editor of his prestigious journal, Atmospheric Environment, for several years. According to him, air pollution occurs when the substances are released into the air. Substances that are pollutants, the substances which can cause harm, are released into the air by human activities. Human activities, they are also called as anthropogenic activities or man-made activities in such concentrations as are sufficient to cause detrimental effect. The point is this, in such concentrations as are sufficient, if the concentration is less than sufficient to cause air detrimental effect or it is so small that it doesn't cause any detrimental effect, then there will be no air pollution. So I repeat it. Air pollution occurs when the substances are released into the air by human activities in such concentrations as are sufficient to cause detrimental effect on human health, vegetation, animals, property, or interferes with the enjoyment of the property by the mankind. Remember, it includes both biotic and abiotic. This is abiotic, this is no life. The property, your house has no life, your car has no life. But if air pollutants affect this also, then they are also air pollutants. Pollutants are released by man-made or anthropogenic activities and or natural activities like eruption of volcanoes, tsunami, etc. Now, one point is important. What is sufficient? There are pollutants like sulfur dioxide, this carbon monoxide, ozone, they are present. Remember, the concentrations of different pollutants required to cause damaging effect are different, not they are same. So each compound has a threshold, an optimum limit. If the concentration exceeds that, only then it is a pollutant. Otherwise, it is not a pollutant. So remember, everything can be pollutant, cannot be pollutant, depending upon its threshold or limiting value. Otherwise, in atmosphere, everything that you conceive, which is toxic, which is harmful, it is present in the atmosphere. It is not damaging us because its concentration is small or below the threshold limit. Major trace atmospheric constituents are these. The major and inert gases are nitrogen, oxygen, argon, neon, helium and krypton. The pollutant gases are less than 0.1%, but their toxic effects are highest. And these are pollutant gases, carbon dioxide. Remember, carbon dioxide as such is not a pollutant, but it is involved in global warming, in increasing the temperature. That's why it is harmful. Methane, hydrogen, nitrous oxide, ozone, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, ammonia, hydrogen, remember, they are present in very small amounts. But amounts are small, but they are most notorious. So when we talk of air pollution, we are concerned with these, not with these. So for causing toxic effect, it is not necessary that something must be present in huge amount. Not necessary, even a small amount can be toxic, harmful, damaging, as in case of air pollutants. How the pollutants are classified? There are several kinds of classifications. First, I deal with primary pollutants, those substances which are directly released into the air from the source are called primary pollutants. For example, when we burn coal has inherently sulfur present in it. When combustion takes place, along with carbon, sulfur also undergoes combustion. It is oxidized by sulfur and sulfur dioxide is released. So it is directly released in the atmosphere, so it is a primary pollutant. Nitrogen oxide, so they are all primary pollutants. Carbon dioxide, chlorofluorocarbons, halons, nitrous oxide, N2 are implicated in global warming. So they are all gaseous primary pollutants. Next, aerosol primary pollutants. Primary aerosol, what is aerosol? Aerosols are dispersions of solid or liquid particulates in air. Air is the dispersion medium, solid particles or liquid drops. If they are suspended in air, then it is called aerosol. For example, fog, mist, they are aerosols. In both cases, the liquid drops are suspended in air. Primary aerosols are directly released in atmosphere. For example, soil particles, fly ash, smoke, they are examples of the primary aerosols. Fly ash is formed when the combustion in the power plant takes place. The fly ash is also released. Soil particles, when any agriculture practice is done, when you walk on the soil surface, the dust goes in the air. Smoke, they are all primary aerosols. Secondary pollutants, they are not directly released into the air, but due to photochemical or thermal reactions of primary pollutants among themselves, these are formed. So, ozone, ground level ozone, how it is formed? It is formed by the reaction in atmosphere, oxygen atom and O2 gas, peroxyacetyl nitrate, photochemical smoke, aldehydes by the oxidation of hydrocarbons, aerosols, ammonium salts. Ammonia and nitric acid, if they react, they form ammonium nitrate. Ammonia, if reacts with sulfuric acid, it forms ammonium sulfate. So they are aerosols. Carbonaceous particles, carbon particles. Source dependent classification of aerosols. This is the whether they are directly released in the atmosphere or they are not directly released in the atmosphere. Now it is based on the source from where the aerosol has come. It is interesting to find out biological aerosols. Seeds, pollens, spores, hair, bacteria, fungi, fragments of plants, animals, insects, microorganisms, algae, protozoa, viruses, they are all biological aerosols. They are suspended in air. Geochemical aerosols, that is, geo means earth. The chemicals taken directly from the earth. For example, when mining is done, during mining practice, some ore particles or other dust particles, they go into the atmosphere. Volcanic eruptions, this comes from the mother earth. The volcano releases lot of material, sulfur dioxide, dust particles, chemicals, okay. Oceanic aerosols, ocean. Ocean is a big source of aerosols, particularly sodium chloride or marine salt. NaCl, it releases into the air. Anthropogenic aerosols, man-made. For example, if coal is undergoes combustion, then soot particles. The smoke comes out, it can get particles. Industrial activities. Whenever the metallurgy, that iron is made, copper is made, cement is made, automobiles, they all release particles in the atmosphere. Other sources of aerosols are forest fires and meteoritic debris. You must have heard, recently there was a fire here in our country and elsewhere. When the fire takes place in the forest, a large area undergoes combustion, and then due to the combustion of wood, leaves, the particles are released, carbon particles are released, they cause aerosol formation. Chemical composition based classification, whether organic or inorganic. Those made from inorganic compounds are inorganic aerosols. These can be soluble or insoluble, two types. For example, ammonium sulfate, this is aerosol. Marine salt, NaCl, they are soluble in water. They are inorganic but soluble. Insoluble minerals, stones, they are inorganic but they are not soluble. Organic aerosols, basically made from organic compounds, from carbon. Organic compound based carbonaceous particles, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, soot, etc. Sources of pollutants, natural sources. The natural sources such as volcanoes, lightning, storm, etc. fall in this category. Lightning, storms, volcano is a big source of dust particles, sulfur dioxide. Lightning, big source of nitrogen oxides. The lightning, when lightning strikes, the temperature is very high. At that temperature, nitrogen and oxygen combined for nitrogen oxide, so it is a big source of nitrogen oxide pollutants. Storms, anthropogenic sources, man-made sources, human activities. There are all kinds of activities, there are several kinds of activities, starting from cooking at homes to running factories. Secondary sources, the process of formation of pollutants in atmosphere due to reactions of natural and man-made pollutants are secondary sources. For example, stationary sources, these are two of two types. Stationary, that is stable, they do not move. Remember, homes, they have kitchen. Factories, power plants, they do not have legs, they do not move. They remain stand at one place, they are stationary. Mobile sources, for example, vehicles, trains, aircraft, ships, they are source of pollution, but these sources are mobile sources. A further subdivision of pollutant sources, indoor pollutant, such as kitchen, outdoor pollutant sources, such as which are outside the homes. Anything which is outside the home gives pollution. Point sources, highly localized, such as power plants, factories. Power plant is one point. There is no power point in the vicinity. Distributed sources, agriculture operations, fields, one field, another field, another field, and cities, one city, another city, and they are distributed sources. Local sources as power plants, global, which are globally concerned, biological processes, volcanoes, they can affect several countries. Inorganic sources as soils, organic sources as agriculture processes. So actually there are numerous types of classification you will find in literature. These are some of the which I discussed here. Criteria air contaminants or criteria pollutants. Environmental Protection Agency of USA selected 6 most common air pollutants which is called criteria pollutants. They are carbon monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, NO2, lead, that is metal, ozone, O3, sulfur dioxide and particulate matter. These criteria air contaminants or CAC they are called. What they do? They cause smoke formation, acid rain and health hazards. Generally emitted by sources in industry, mining, transportation, that is movement of vehicles, electric generation, agriculture. Mostly these are produced by combustion of fossil fuels or industrial. What is fossil fuel? A fuel which is taken out from the mother earth. The earth is the source, for example, coal, for example, petroleum, for example, diesel, for example, natural gas. They are all fossil fuels. Only these substances have defined allowable concentrations in ambient air and national air quality standards. For them, the standards have been decided. So, no more than this much carbon monoxide in the atmosphere. If vehicles should not release more than this much amount of CO, this much amount of nitrogen oxide, that is why the pollution check is done on the vehicles. This is based on the amount that must be checked. This standard is revised every 5 years. These have been determined to present a general risk to the health of public. Remember, in case of pollutants, you can never say what are the possible toxic effects of carbon monoxide. Because you know 2 toxic effects, it may have 10 other which you do not know. So you can give a general idea that this carbon monoxide can do this. So that's why these have been determined to present a general risk to the health of the public, not a specific effect. Hazard is another thing. This is a well-known term. US Environmental Protection Agency has another list of about 200 substances believed to cause adverse environmental health effects. Okay, and these include such well-known compounds, benzene, asbestos, arsenic, nickel compounds, formaldehyde, radionuclides, etc. From this list, compounds can be deleted or added any time. So this is always under revision. Man-made processes responsible for air pollutants. How we are, most important is combustion of fuels. What is combustion? The oxidation of any substance by oxygen is combustion. And why combustion is carried out by human beings? Because it gives energy. As energy is used for doing many things. Undoubtedly, combustion of fossil fuels such as coal, petroleum products, hydrocarbon, etc. is the most significant source of pollutants. Pollutants released are CO2, major culprit of global warming, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, unwanted hydrocarbons, nitrogen oxides, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. It has a symbol of common PAHS, unwanted hydrocarbons. Remember your car, your scooter, your vehicles, the petrol or diesel, they are nothing but hydrocarbons. If the hydrocarbon that is not, which has not gone undergone combustion and it is released to the atmosphere, that is unburnt hydrocarbon has been released to the atmosphere and pollution has been caused. The toxic metals in different chemical forms are also released by combustion. For example, if coal has some mercury, that mercury is also released. Incineration, what happens, the municipal dust as many times, particularly in mohallas, in localities, the sweeper comes and wards it. So the match stick to it and it undergoes combustion. But it is a dangerous thing, it should not be done because it has plastic material which have chlorine compounds and these produce highly toxic and carcinogenic chlorinated dioxins and fumes. So that's why any plastic should not be allowed to undergo combustion. Man-made processes responsible for air pollutants. High temperature sources, these are the names of high temperature sources. High temperature metallurgical processes for such as smelting and brick making release pollutants. For example, if you see how the iron is made in Bhilai, the temperature is very high, it is red hot. I have seen the iron flowing. When brick making releases pollutants, carbon dioxide manufacture of cement, sulfur dioxide smelting of sulfide ores. You use copper sulfide to get copper metal. Toxic metals like arsenic present as impurity. Hydrogen fluoride, brick making and cryolite smelting for aluminium, they are source of hydrogen fluoride. Evaporation of volatile organic compounds, VOCs. Now VOCs is a name, which is well-known name. They are pollutants, volatile organic compounds which has room temperature. They evaporate, that's why they are called VOCs. From the evaporation of VOCs takes place from solvents in use. Many kinds of solvents are used in industries. Solvents are used in paints, petroleum industries, mining and gas leakage, which is of pesticide in agriculture. So they are the sources of volatile organic compounds. Sources of sulfur dioxide, one of the major pollutants, SO2. The combustion of sulfur, S plus O2 forms SO2. The natural source is volcano, but it comes once in a while. This is common thing. Oxidation of sulfur gas is produced by decomposition of plants, but remember plants have very small amount of sulfur. So sulfur dioxide released by plants will not be much, but it is there. Sulfur based hot springs and geysers. This is also not a big source. Natural sulfur dioxide by volcanoes released high in the atmosphere. Yes, where there is a volcanic activity, at that place huge amount of sulfur dioxide may be released. SO2 background concentration remains low, about 1 parts per billion. At any time in the atmosphere, normally, if it is not much polluted, this much sulfur dioxide is always present. Man-made sources. Biggest source is coal combustion. Coal combustion is the biggest man-made source of atmospheric SO2. Depending upon its source, coal contains 1 to 9% sulfur. 1 is very low, 9% is very high. For example, poor quality coal, lignite, it has high sulfur. In India, the sulfur in coal is not much high. The sulfur is present to 2 forms in coal as inclusions. In the mineral content of the coal, for example, FeS2, some inorganic sulfide present in the coal, it is removed mechanically by pulverizing the coal before combustion. As part of coal matrix bonded to the complex coal structure. If sulfur is bonded to the carbon forms a covalent bond with it, then removal of such a sulfur is very difficult and costly, so it cannot be done. Petroleum, during refining of crude oil, some SO2 is released in the atmosphere, for example, at Mathura refinery. There is a gas that despite their best effort to control SO2 emission, some SO2 is released. Smelting or the roasting of sulfide ore, for example, nickel and copper sulfides. SO2 is released. Now this actually what happens, the industries are running for business, for earning money and producing goods at cheaper cost. So if the amount of sulfur dioxide is large or sufficient, then this sulfur dioxide is used to form H2SO4 or sometimes to get sulfur elemental sulfur. Natural gas is mainly H2S. The CNG, compressed natural gas, that has methane, but it has some H2SO4, very small amount of H2SO4. This H2SO4 is cleaned before CNG is supplied. Paper and pulp manufacture, when the paper is made, wood pulping, it needs sulfite, Na2SO3. Okay, this is used there. This chemical is used in wood pulping, and therefore sulfur, it is a source of sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere. NOx. Remember this, NOx combines two compounds, NO and NO2. But remember, not N2O. NOx means only NO, nitrous oxide, nitric oxide, and NO2, nitrogen dioxide. Natural sources of NOx are biomass burning, lightning, and soils. Soil by aerobic biodegradation, NOx are produced. Biomass burning, whenever any wood undergoes combustion, at the temperature that is produced, at that temperature, nitrogen oxygen combined to form NOx, that is biomass burning. Lightning, I already explained. Anthropogenic sources, high temperature sources, whether it's a kitchen, whether it's a fuel, whether anything which occurs at high temperature, nitrogen, air is there, then nitrogen and oxygen, they react to form NO. This is an equilibrium reaction. This equilibrium is very small at low temperature, but as the temperature increases, the value of the equilibrium constant increases, and this reaction shifts to right. So at high temperature, more of NO is formed. So NO is formed from N2 and O2 reaction only at high temperature, not at room temperature. At room temperature, virtually there is no reaction. What would have happened if had there been a reaction between N2 at room temperature? There would have been no oxygen, and there would have been no life on the earth. Carbon monoxide, it is a criterion air pollutant. It is a very dangerous substance. It is tasteless and odorless, due to which one is unable to feel, recognize its inhalation, which is life-threatening. What happens if in a closed room, particularly in winter, you sleep and you allow cold water to heat up the room? If there is not sufficient ventilation, slowly and slowly the oxygen in the room will be used up, oxygen will decrease, and the combustion will form CO. The beauty or dangerous thing about CO is you get some kind of, by inhaling, some kind of nasha. So you don't feel it, you enjoy it, and this enjoyment costs life. Natural sources of carbon monoxide. The natural sources are oxidation of methane, terpenes. Terpenes are released by plants. Isoprene, again released by plants. Remember, there are many organic compounds and inorganic compounds which are released by plants in their natural activities. Forest fires, lightning, seed germination, etc. They are natural sources. The background concentration of is 100 ppb, and it is the most abundant criteria air contaminant. Man-made sources are industrial. Man-made sources are high temperature sources, automobiles, industrial units. Due to incomplete combustion of fuel, remember, carbon should be completely oxidized to CO2 by your C plus O2 CO2. What happens? Somehow the reaction occurs C plus O2, twice C plus O2, twice CO. The CO is not further oxidized to CO2 completely, then what happens? Part of carbon is oxidized to CO and part is oxidized to CO2. Oxygen, this ozone. Ozone is an interesting gas. It has both roles. It is savior of life. It is necessary in the stratosphere. But in troposphere, in ground level, ozone is a pollutant, it is a toxic material. So same substance can behave in both ways. That classic example is ozone. How it is formed? The photo and nitrogen oxide, which is present in atmosphere, by visible radiation of 390 nanometer, it dissociates, give you oxygen. This is ground state oxygen atom. Ground state oxygen atom and NO. This O reacts with O2 to form O3. This M is the third body. The purpose of this third body is to remove extra heat that is removed, and energy that is removed. If it is not removed, then this will form the excellent state and reconvert to it. Ozone reacts with NO to form NO2. So this is a three-step cycle. NO2 was used up and regenerated, and in this cycle, ozone is formed. Volatile organic compounds, another pollutant. The uses are solvents, paints and varnishes, plants, automobiles and industries. Control of CO pollution, how it can be controlled? CO formation in internal combustion engine is controlled. How it is controlled? It is this is. Three-way catalytic converter, all the vehicles in India. Now they are mandated to use catalytic converters. They are factory, the factories, the all, they are, all factories are required to, this catalytic converter must be in any car that is sold out. Now what it does so many things. It oxidizes CO2 carbon dioxide. So no carbon monoxide is released in the atmosphere. Hydrocarbon, that is diesel or petrol, it is oxidized to CO2. And NOx that is formed because of high temperature, it is reduced to N2 and O2. So it is done to check the release of carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons and NOx. Chemically, the catalytic converter is a ceramic honeycomb type thing. It is impregnated with catalyst, platinum, palladium, and rhodium. Remember, they are costly metals. They are used in it. So that's why it is a catalytic converter that is used in cars. It's a costly material. It has two chambers. Engine gases convert containing CO, NOx, and SC enter the chamber. At the surface of the catalyst, reaction of SC with water produces hydrogen, this reaction. And this hydrogen reduces NO2, N2. So this, what has happened? Hydrocarbon as well as NO, both have been removed. In the second stage, then excess air is pumped into the exhaust stream to make available oxygen based on catalyst, these catalysts, CO is CO2, and SC into CO2 and water. So this is how catalytic converter works. Urban air pollution. Now we know the cities and villages, rural areas, which are more polluted. The cities are more polluted than the rural areas. Why? Because of massive growth in the size and population of the cities, addition of huge number of automobiles each year. And what happens? Following urban characteristics seriously affect the urban climate. They are typical, peculiar to cities only. Creation of urban heat islands, I will explain later on. Lower average wind speeds, increase in fog frequency, change in the vertical structure of the lower boundary layer, formation of mesoscale circulation systems, etc. These are the some major things which happen in cities. The major urban air pollutants are waste heat, sulfur dioxide, CO, NO2, hydrocarbon compounds, photochemical oxidants, suspended particulate matter. How come the waste heat is very important thing? In cities, there are large number of air conditioners. Almost 30% homes or 25% homes, they have air conditioner. What happens if your room is cool, where the heat has gone? The first law of thermodynamics says that heat, the energy cannot be created nor can be destroyed. So the energy you have not destroyed, it you have simply released outside. So it is in the outside, that heat is outside. Another thing, the walls and houses, they are made of concrete, stone or cement. During daytime, they become very hot, they absorb energy and store it. And after it, they start releasing this heat. So each of the building becomes a source of heat. So that is how waste heat is released in the atmosphere. These are the sources of waste heat. Automobiles and transportation exhaust, you know, how hot is the exhaust of the car or motorcycle. If you touch it, your skin will go off. It's so hot. Industrial emissions. Power plant fumes, the smoke coming out of the power plant, it is also very hot. Domestic heating and cooking, air conditioning, excess heat is stored in the buildings, pavements, roads. You move in the summer, I mean, in the next month, if you move barefoot on the road, you will have trouble moving. Waste heat is an important aspect of urban temperature and moisture content. It is unique to our environment due to dense network of sources of heat. Every house has a kitchen. Every house has an air conditioner or some other source of heat. It is likely to aid the formation of secondary pollutants. In urban centers, due to lack of plant cover, the number of plants is very small. Most of the heat is released as sensible heat and a small portion as infrared radiation and latent heat. In India, waste heat influences the most noticeable in summers. We all know it. Automobile exhaust emissions, the vehicles, what they release? Carbon monoxide due to incomplete combustion, unwanted hydrocarbons from the exhaust of your vehicles, evaporative losses from fuel tank, carburetor, etc. It may be interesting for you to know, if you put your vehicle outside for some days and you put 5 liter petrol, after 10 days you will find the petrol is not 5 liter. What has happened to it? It has evaporated. But evaporative losses become less if your tank is full. So if you keep your tank of your vehicle full of the fuel, then the losses due to emission, losses from evaporation are less. Sulfur dioxide, but in fuels the sulfur dioxide is not much, but this is important. Because at high temperature nitrogen oxygen combined to form NOx, organic inorganic lead. Lead is 10. Earlier anti-lock compound was used to increase its octane rating, efficiency of the petrol engine, but in most of the countries this is not being used. Smoke should be mostly diesel type vehicles. You see the smoke coming out of a diesel vehicle from truck, you will find it's black. These soot particles, they are polymeric substances having carbon chains. Particulates and odor due to partial oxidation of hydrocarbons into aldehydes, particularly in the cities. For example, in Delhi, here your eyes will have a burning sensation in winter in a city center where there is a high traffic, because this is due to the oxidation of hydrocarbons into aldehydes. So this irritation, eye irritation, is due to aldehydes. Petrol engines release larger amount of CO. Diesel engines release more of NOx, smoke and odor. So that is the difference between these two. How CO is monitored? CO is this tank, this is name of the technique, details are not given. Non-dispersive infrared method is used. Smoke, for measuring of the smoke, Hartley smoke meter is used. Now, how we can control the pollution by our vehicles? The proper maintenance of the engine. This will increase the life of the engine, better efficiency, better mileage. The petrol tank should be full. Use of catalytic converters, it is not necessary. It is necessary everywhere now. Regional and global pollution. Pollutants released at one location are known to be transported over large distances and sometimes without much dilution from one country to another. Thus, the effects of pollution are regional and global. An example of global effect of air pollution is worldwide release, increase the concentration of greenhouse gases. Because actually they have a long life. CO2 has a long life, 44 years. CFC has a long life of 90 years. N2 has a life of 150 years. So during this, the time is sufficient to move from India to USA. Arctic haze, it is caused by air pollution in the Arctic pole, North Pole, owing to the transport of pollutants from Northern Europe and Russia. Severe pollution episodes, you must have heard Bhopal episode, London smoke. Remember, the pollutants which are released in the atmosphere, they do not stay forever in the atmosphere. What happens? They are removed from the atmosphere. So there are two processes. One, the rate of emission or formation of the pollutants. Number, the rate of release or removal of the pollutants. If this is greater than this, there is a more release than removal, then what will happen? The pollution will increase. Pollutants are removed how? By ventilation, by destruction, by dispersion winds, by vertical transport, or removed from physical or chemical processes. What happened in Bhopal? That was 1st or 2nd December night. It was winter. The wind speed was very low. Methyl isocyanide was released from the factory, Union Carbide factory. Because of low temperature, the wind speed was very low. So therefore, MISO could not be transported. It remained confined near the factory. It traveled to other places at a very small speed. That is the reason for the severe episode. If wind speed is high, then dispersal will take place. So in summer, the disaster would not have been that big. Indian air quality standards, so these are the different pollutants. And how much is allowed? How much should be allowed? Now, if it is more than that, then it is toxic disturbance. In this module on air pollution, The definition of air pollution, air polluted was explained. How the pollutants are classified, primary and secondary, their definitions were given, their examples were given, the sources of pollutants were classified and mentioned and explained to you. How the urban pollution, the pollution in the cities take place, how it is different from the rural areas, and what are the consequences, damaging consequences of the urban pollution, it was explained to you. Thank you.